Hello everybody, I'm Eli, and today we're going to be working on gluing our spear together. This is video number 3 in the series, and we're going to take a real close look at how to properly glue this up, as well as several different ways of doing the glue up, or several different styles, I would rather say. We're going to do 3 different styles of glue up, so let's go ahead and get started.
All right, we're ready to get started with the glue up. As you can see, I've already started. I've got a pretty good pile of my pentagons over here that are already dried and ready to go. At the beginning of this project, I said that I wanted 120 pieces, or 120 of these smaller triangles, so that I could get 2 spears, 2 dodecahedrons. I ended up with roughly 230 triangles. So I have enough to do 3. So what I have going on here is 2 separate styles of glue ups, and overall, and you'll see later on in the video, there's going to be a total of 3 different styles of this dodecahedron, or this spear that I'm making. I'm going to start off with the easiest of the glue ups, and I've already sanded these pieces, but what you want to do is your triangle has 2 short sides and 1 longer side. We're going to be sanding the 2 shorter sides before we glue them up. We don't need to sand the longer side because it doesn't glue to anything just yet. And I have a stiff plastic block. It's 1/2 inch thick. Length and width is whatever you want to make it. Thickness, whatever. You just want something really stiff to sand your edges with. Right off the saw, these pieces were good enough to glue together. There's no saw marks or anything like that. I was using a very sharp blade. It was brand new. And the way that I was cutting real slow with each cut made it so that these cuts were almost like they just came off of a joiner. The reason that I sand them is because they've been sitting a couple days, and I want to rough those edges up before I put the glue on them. And typically what I'll do is I will only sand the amount of blocks that I'm going to be gluing up at that particular sitting. So if I know I can glue together, say, 5 of these pentagons, then I'll go ahead and sand up enough of these small squares to do the 5 pentagons. And that's just how I've been doing it. So let's go ahead and get started on this glue up. The first thing that I'm going to use is this is just clear packing tape. There's nothing special about it. I'm going to rip a piece off and lay it so that it is sticky side up. I'm going to get some of my glue, and I just put it in a little puddle. Nothing special here. Some people like to use a brush to put the glue on. For me, it doesn't really matter. I'll just use my finger. And we're going to put glue on the small side, the shorter sides, not the longer side. This goes pretty quick, pretty easy. And the thing about this is, obviously, you don't want to use too much glue, and you don't want to use too little of glue. If you use too much glue, you're just wasting glue, and the pieces kind of slide around on you while you're trying to glue it up. So it makes it a little more time consuming using too much glue. But if you use too little glue, obviously you're going to end up with a dry joint, and you don't want that because your piece could fall apart later on down the road. Now what I'm doing is I'm lining up the back corners of my triangles. I'm not so worried about the front corners because I randomly took about 50 of these triangles out of the box, just reached my hand in and grabbed them, and I measured them with my micrometer, and every single one of them was within 1/100th of an inch, because I really took the time while cutting them out to make sure that they were all as near perfect as possible. And so that tells me that if I line my back corners up, that my front corner should be just fine. And this tape is also flexible enough to where once you pull it together and you start putting pressure on it, you'll be able to still move the pieces around and get them into the shape that you want them to be in with no problem. Need a little more glue here. A little too much glue on that one. So as you can see, it doesn't take a lot of time to get those glued up. My next step here is I have one of these razor knives, and I use this knife on literally every project that I do. It's like my go-to tool. I use it all the time, so if you don't have one, I would recommend getting it. I'm gonna get down in to this group, to this space here, and I'm going to cut. There's a little piece of tape on the end here. I don't know if you can see it or not, but I'm going to cut that out of there. And the reason why is when I fold this up, I don't want that piece of tape folding into that joint, because then you're going to end up with a dry seam. You're not ever going to get that tape out, and this piece would pretty much be garbage after that. And then I'm just going to trim off the excess tape that's around the edge. That just makes it easier when you go to peel the tape off. You don't have all this jumbled up tape everywhere. You want to get yourself a little tiny piece of the clear packing tape, and when you fold it up on itself, you'll see the glue start to squeeze out. You want to come on the back side and just put that little piece of tape right there. Now that tape's not really doing much. It's just kind of holding it together and keeping the pieces snug, but it's not doing anything really to hold it together. It's just kind of holding it in place at this point. Now you can see I have a lot of glue squeeze out here. I want to get rid of that. Even though that's the inside of the spear and nobody will ever see it, the reason that you want to get rid of that glue is because you're going to be looking at the way these joints line up, and if you got a big puddle of glue in there, you're not going to be able to see that. I'm just using, you can see it's a pretty small rubber band. It doesn't have a lot of tension to it. You don't want a lot of pressure on these. The more pressure you have on there, the more likely your joints are to be open. And this basically, if I wrap this one rubber band three times, if I can do it right, sometimes it's kind of a pain on these smaller pieces. That little bit of rubber band is just like you holding it finger tight. It's not too much pressure, and I really like the way that it works out. Because you got five sides here, when you're done wrapping this, you're gonna have your rubber bands should be in the shape of an A across this piece in order to get all the sides held down properly. And I'll show you, I'm almost done here. So those are all the rubber bands you'll need. And if I come up a little bit closer, you'll see that I actually have more glue squeeze out now. And I'm going to get in there with my finger and just kind of get that out of there. Because again, you want to be able to see how your joints are lining up. And after I get my rubber bands on, you're going to go around the pentagon and just adjust them so that the top points are lined up. You're not so worried about the bottom as you are the top. And I'm looking for two things here. I'm looking for the wood to be in line with each other here, but at the very point where it comes together, if the points are off a little bit and you have to sand that point off, then when you glue your spear together, your joints aren't going to line up perfectly. So because I know each of these triangles is within a hundredth of an inch, I'm going to feel each corner with my finger and make sure that they are aligned perfect and that there's nothing out of place there. Because if you're going to put this much time and effort into a project, it's worth the extra effort, the extra time, just to look at it and make sure it's good. Now, the other thing that I've kind of figured out while gluing these together is this glue is kind of slippery and the pieces will kind of jumble around in there. So what I will typically do is I'll glue it up and I'll set it aside for maybe 2 minutes and let that glue tack up a little bit. It's not tacked up to the point where it can't be moved. It's just gonna give it a lot more sturdiness when you pick it up and look at it again, because after 2 minutes you want to give it another fine adjustment because it will move slightly. And after that fine adjustment's done, you just set it to the side and you're ready to go. All right, we're ready for the next glue up now. For this glue up, I've actually already cut the pieces that I need, but I'm going to show you how I do it. I've got a piece of maple veneer here. If I'm not mistaken, this maple veneer is a 42nd of an inch thick. What you're going to do, or what I did anyways, is I took one of my triangles and I'm going to place it on the end there. I'm going to make a little mark because I want my veneer to be slightly wider than the thickness of the triangle, if that makes any sense. And I'm going to just cut a straight line. Yeah, and I'll show you in a second. And again, I'm just using my yellow knife that I use all the time. Now, when I made these initial strips, I cut the first one with a razor blade, and then I set my table saw, and I ripped them all, and it was a really quick. I mean, it only took me about 15 minutes to cut all the veneer that I needed, but you can still do this at home with just a razor knife. Next thing, and you can see, I don't know if you can see in the camera or not, but my piece of veneer is just slightly wider than the thickness of my triangle. If you're doing it at home by hand, you can just line up one of your pieces and cut that angle, and then mark the length and go ahead and square that off and cut it. I'm trying to keep everything in frame here, but it's kind of hard to pay attention to what I'm doing and the camera at the same time. And then what you can do is you can use that one piece as a pattern to mark all your others and cut them. Now, for this glue up, when I put the veneer in between my joints, I'm not trying to bring the veneer right up to the point, because what I'm going to do with these, and you can see the veneer inside of this one if you look. It's kind of hard to see on video, but there's a piece of veneer in there. But I don't need them to line up perfectly in the center. If I was going to do that, I would glue it up completely different. I would take these small pieces, and I would take a flat piece of wood, and I would glue them individually, one side at a time. I don't know if you can see that, but I would glue them individually one side at a time with a squeeze clamp and a piece of foam on top. And I'd glue up 30 of them, and then I'd flip them over and glue up 30, and I would trim them, and then I would glue them together. But because what I'm going to do with these here is I'm going to put an inlay piece in the center of each of these pentagons, so I don't need them to line up perfect in this corner. They can actually be back just a little bit if you want them to. And I don't know if you can see in the video, I'll bring it as close and see if it'll focus on that, but my veneer pieces don't line up in the middle. So I'm going to go ahead and show you how to do that. It's basically the same process. I'm going to take a piece of clear tape, lay it sticky side up, and give myself some glue here. Now, when I'm gluing these up, I actually want the glue to be a little heavier on the sides that I'm gluing up, because I've learned over time that that veneer will suck up quite a bit of glue. So if you put the same amount of glue on these that you put on your other ones, it's probably not going to be enough glue. As you can see, I'm just placing those pieces of veneer right on the side of the triangle. And the reason I'm doing that is if you don't put the veneer on there, the glue tends to just run down to the bottom of that triangle. And at the top of the joint, it's not as good. You don't have as much glue squeeze out, and sometimes it can even be missing some glue. So you want to make sure that you just take your piece of veneer and just stick it to the side there. It holds, it just helps hold the glue in place, that's all. Now these are much more time consuming than the other ones because it's really hard to line up the points when you've got a piece of veneer in there kind of obstructing your view. So the actual glue up time is more time consuming, and that's why I have less of those done than the other, because you kind of have to really focus more on what you're doing. You got, instead of gluing up five pieces, you're actually gluing up a total of 10 in this ring. You've got five triangles and five little slices of veneer that are sitting in between each joint. And as you'll see in a second, it also makes the clamp up, or the fit a little more complicated as well, because you're kind of competing with that veneer moving around in there and trying to see what's going on. And this is the same process. I'm going to get in there and just cut out that little wedge of tape. And again, the reason I cut that wedge out is because I have had that tape get kind of stuck in that glue joint before, and it's a kind of a pain in the ass once the tape's on there to go back and readjust it. And just trimming this extra tape off real quick makes it easier for your glue up, because you're not wrestling with that sticky tape that's just on there getting in your way. And again, this process is, that was pieces way too big. This process is basically exactly the same as the other than you're trying to wedge some small pieces of veneer in between your joints. And again, we're going to kind of hold it together and then put our extra piece of tape on the back to hold that joint in place while I'm getting the rubber bands on there. And these pieces of veneer can be really tricky sometimes. Sometimes they'll slip around quite a bit, and sometimes they don't want to move at all. And it makes the glue up a lot more complicated. And on this one, I'm not as worried about getting the glue off the joints like I did with the last one, because even if you get the glue off of the joint, it's kind of hard to see here, but the veneer is sticking up past the base a little bit. So even if there's no glue in there, it's still really hard to see how they're lining up. And you have to go more based on what is on the other side of the triangle, on the top side. That's part of why I use clear tape, is I want to be able to see on both sides as much as I can. Trying to sort through my rubber bands and get the ones that are going to work the best. You don't want too thick of a rubber band, or a rubber band with too much pull on it, or elasticity, because if you have too much, then those triangles tend to move around a lot, and it makes it actually harder to get your glue up done right. Alright, so I've got all my rubber bands on, and in this case, you really have to take your time to make sure you're lined up. You have to look at it dead on and kind of compare your two points. And you also want to flip it over to the top side, and you're looking at the two points up here to make sure that they're not overlapping each other like this. Again, if they are, then your glue joint in the end isn't going to line up with the rest of them when you go ahead and try and glue your spear together. So just take your time with these. If you decide to go this route, you're really going to have some patience, because it is not the easiest glue up in the world. Actually, it's kind of complicated overall. I'm like trying to focus on everything that's going on here. Sometimes you have to peel the tape back so you can get a good look at it, but I'm just peeling the tape back off of the corner there, just enough to get a look at how my joint is actually fitting together. And if you see that one side needs a little more pressure, go ahead and throw another rubber band on there, on the sides that may or may not need it, and it'll help you out a lot. Most of the time I find that I don't need that extra rubber band, but on occasion I do. And I don't know if that's because I have too much glue in there or what it is, but on occasion it happens. Now I'm going to try and show you. As you can see, I'm spending a lot more time messing with this one than I did with the other one. And that's because those pieces of veneer in there actually complicate it quite a bit. They make lining this up way more complicated, way more time consuming. So if I had to guesstimate, it takes roughly twice as long to actually align and glue up one of these pieces versus one without the veneer. I've been messing with it for a few minutes here, and it's still not 100% lined up. All right, we're much closer now. Now again, what we're going to do, it's close enough at this point, so what I'm going to do is just set it off to the side, let it sit for a minute or two, and then I'll come back and readjust it again, and then it should be good. And I'm just going to continue that process until I have everything glued up that I need. So we'll come back in a minute and we'll start on the next step of this entire glue up process. Alright, we're back at my shop, at my house where I keep my lathe, and I have to be back here in order to sand some parts in order to glue the spear together. I do have a little bit of a confession to make. At this point in shooting the videos, all three spears are already glued together. The first spear that I glued together was this one, and I shot the footage for it. And when I went inside the house to edit the footage, I realized that my frame rate was way too high. So about a minute into the video, the frames were too much for the camera, too much for everything that I had to edit it to handle. So the video would go into slow motion, the audio was all messed up, it didn't work out. So I went ahead and I shot it again. And when I shot it the second time, I was gluing up this sphere. And when I went inside the house to edit it, I didn't have any audio. For some odd reason, my microphone didn't connect to the camera, and I wasn't able to have any audio on any of it. So I decided to reshoot it again, because I had another spear to glue up, which was this one. So I shot the third one, and somehow the light settings on my camera had gotten messed up, so everything was blurry, way too bright, everything looked foggy. Some of the video didn't have sound, some of it did, so I don't know what I did, but my strong point is not shooting video, it's working with wood. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how to glue these together, but I have to do it using the pieces that I had left over, which you can see are these seven pieces here. when I glued up all my pieces, I had 36 of these pentagons to make the three spheres. It's 180 triangles. And out of all of those spheres that I glued up, these three here that you see in this pile were the only three that I kind of messed up on. And you can see I wrote no good, or I marked it. And what you can see is that there was a gap, a slight gap in some of my joints on these. You can see it on the end here. On this one, you can see the bad gap here. That ended up happening because I was on these three, I was kind of rushing the glue process. These all came out good enough to use, but I had extra, so I didn't need them. And you can see the difference, the big difference. Hopefully you can see that on the camera, is how tight those joints are versus the three that I messed up here. So now we're going to go ahead and move on to gluing up the spheres. Okay, the reason that I have my sander set up in the way that it is set up, as you can see, I set a board at an angle here. And the reason that I did that is because in video number two, I was talking about adjusting our angles and all of that stuff. And we adjusted our angles really carefully on the table saw in order to pull this pentagon together with really nice tight seams. But now we have this angle back here, which actually connects the five pentagons together to create the circle. And I kind of knew from the get-go, from the start, that it was going to be impossible to get this angle back here to be 100% perfect. I knew that when I came to glue the spear together, that I was going to need to make some adjustments, and I gave a lot of thought as to how I was going to do that. My first thought was to set up a sled on the table saw, and I actually tried that. It didn't work out very well. It was too dangerous. It wasn't going to work. And so I decided to set up the sander. And what I'm trying to adjust here is, you can see that I have a gap there when I hold these three pieces together. And I'm just holding them finger tight. And if I fold that down and I connect all the corners, you can see how wide of a gap I have there. Now, I went ahead and measured the angle before and after I set up the sander for this, and it turns out that my angle on these pieces was off by 1 degree. It was like 0.98 degrees or something like that. And that can be because of many reasons. It could be because this angle was slightly off. I don't really think it was. I think really what ended up happening is, it's almost impossible to set that table saw to a perfect angle. So when I cut this angle, I think it was off just slightly. And there's really nothing you can do about that other than when you come to the point where you're ready to glue them together, you adjust it then. So what I did was I set my angle at my board here at the angle that I already had cut. And then I slowly raised it or lowered it. In this case, I had to raise it to kind of shave a little bit of that angle off the bottom. With a shim under there, I slowly raised it a little bit and a little bit and a little bit until all of my pieces came together perfectly. Now, you should be able to hold these pieces together with no clamps, with no clamps, no tape, anything like that. You should be able to hold them together with your fingers just like that. And you should have a perfectly tight seam. And I don't know if you can see it in the video, I'll try and hold it up close there, but that seam is as tight as it's ever going to get. And what I do with that is I have a light, it's got a magnet on it, so see if I can stick it there. And what I did in order to figure it out was I held the light behind the piece and I put the angles together only with my hands. I don't want to have any pressure on it whatsoever. And I'm going to hold it up and shine that light through there. And I know you guys aren't going to be able to see what I'm seeing, so I'm just going to have to tell you there is no light coming through those gaps. They're extremely tight. And in order to set my angle up to be that accurate, it took me about, I'm going to say, a little over an hour to get my lathe set up. I'm sorry, I'm just setting my light up again. It took me about an hour to get this all together, but again, I'm gluing together 36 pentagons, so that 1 hour to set this up is overall nothing. It probably saved me, I don't know, 5 or 6 hours of trying to figure everything out. So once I got that set up, I came in, you're just sanding them by hand. You're gonna push your piece up into that sander, and you're gonna connect the 2 points and look at the edge as you're sanding it. Where the 2 points come together, it should meet directly in the center of that seam. It shouldn't be off any, and you'll be able to see by looking at it if it's off, even in the slightest bit. So take your time to make sure that you get those as close as humanly possible. And then after I did that, I just randomly, because I've got 36 of these, I grabbed probably 10 or 12 of them. And what I did was I just set my caliper here really accurately on one corner. I locked it into place. And then I just randomly checked corners on all of my pentagons here. And they were all, I'm going to say, within about a hundredth of an inch after I got done. And I did have to do some fine tuning, and not all of these have been sanded yet, so I'm just going to show you real quick what that looks like. Then I'm going to check my edges, and anywhere that I'm off just a little bit, it's just going to be the slightest adjustment, just a little bit. That's it. It took about that much time per octagon, per pentagon, not octagon, per pentagon to get all my edges sanded. So we're going to come back in just a second. We're going to start gluing these things up. All right, we're ready to start our glue up process. I'm going to adjust this camera just a hair, give it more centered here. In order to do this glue up process, you're going to need some packing tape for the first glue up. After the first glue up, you won't need tape for anything. And what you're going to do is get yourself 3 pieces about an inch wide, inch and a half wide, and just kind of stick them off to the side. I don't know if you can see it in the camera, but I have 3 pieces there already. And the initial glue up is going to consist of 3 of your octagons. After that, I'm going to glue each piece one at a time and create my sphere. But I need a starting point, so that's what we're going to do right now. What I'm going to do is I'm going to take these 3 pieces and I'm going to glue them kind of in a, it's going to make up a quarter of the entire sphere. And I'm not going to use too much glue. I do want a good coating on there, but I want enough to get definitely squeeze out, but I don't want enough to where I just have globs of glue everywhere that I just, you know, I don't need a big mess. So I don't know if you can see that, but that's plenty of glue for what we're doing here. And you want to coat each side of the each side that's going to go together. So I'm going to take these 2 pieces and we'll put a piece of tape on this side, and then I'm going to line these 2 corners up. And you want to get these corners as close as humanly possible. The more time you take to get your joints right, the less effort you're going to have down the road trying to adjust pieces to fit. And on all 3 octagons, I really didn't have to struggle to get the pieces to fit because I spent a lot of time making sure that my angles were as good as I could get them. You can see I got a little bit of squeeze out there. I'm just going to set that down for a second while I put glue on, kind of want to keep them together a little bit, while I put glue on my 3rd piece. But back to what I was saying, how easy and how fast your glue up goes is going to be directly determined by how much time and effort you put into making sure that your angles were as accurate as they could be. Sometimes the best thing to do is slow down and take your time, because in the long run it's going to save you more time to do that than it would if you tried to rush through it because you were being impatient. I'm just going to put a little piece of tape on this corner here, and then we're going to stick these three pieces together just like that. And then the third piece of tape is going to go right here. And I'm going to stick it to one side. You can see it's still up. Hopefully you can see that. And I'm going to push them together real tight here. And then I'm going to fold it down. Now, the thing about this tape is, it's not giving any pressure to this glue up. It's just holding it together. It's not acting as a clamp. There's no force exerted by that tape. It's just there to be an extra set of hands, basically. Now, I'm going to use three rubber bands to add the pressure that I need. And you want all three of these rubber bands to be the exact same size and the exact same elasticity. You don't want a really thick, hard pull rubber band on one and then a thin one on the other. You know, and you just want all this, the more equal you can make it, the better, because we want to create equal pressure on all three sides here. The first thing I do is squeeze it together until I see the squeeze out, and I'm just going to hold it by hand for a second. That's going to give it a little bit of suction to hold it all together. And then I'm going to wrap these bands. Oh, that one broke. These rubber bands have been pretty well abused over the course of this project. Just like that. Number two. Oops. There we go. And let me find another rubber band that's going to work here. Hopefully I got another one. I've broken quite a few of them over this project because the edges of these wood pieces are actually pretty sharp, so it kind of cuts through the rubber band. Now, I'll show you what I have happening here with the rubber bands in just a second. Let me grab a paper towel. Okay. As you can see, there's kind of a specific pattern that I have going on here. Each one is pulled across the side of one and coming across the other. And what that's doing is it's giving me the same directional force on all three pieces. I don't have one coming from a different angle or something weird like that. The reason why I want to do that is I want to keep all of the forces holding this thing together as equal as possible. And I have this little flat razor here. We're going to get to that in just a second. But what I want to do now is I want to come in and clean this glue out with my finger and a paper towel. I want to get it as, you know, cleaned off of there as possible, because what I'm looking at is the joints down in here. I'm not worried about the outside so much. I can see it through the tape, and I'll get to that in just a second. But right now, I'm looking to see if I have any gaps in my joints here. And I can see that I have a slight gap there, but if I give it a little pressure, it pulls it in tight. And the same there, and the same there. So by doing that, I can see exactly where my joints are. And it's probably hard to see in the camera, but these joints are extremely tight. The next thing I want to do is get my razor blade and just clean that little bit of glue out of the corners. I want to be able to see those corners really clearly, because it is extremely important. These corners right here will actually tell you more than anything else, because you can see if your points are lined up And right here, I don't know if you can see it, but my point is obviously not lined up, so I'm going to just adjust it slightly by hand. And I can see that this side is slightly higher than this side. So I want to kind of wiggle it a little bit and get it down to where it's even. And I'm going to go around and do that for all the sides. And this is going to take a few minutes. I mean, it doesn't take a long time. This first glue up actually takes the longest out of all of them, because you're making a lot of fine adjustments and you're trying to get everything exactly where it needs to be. It's like, if you start off on the right foot, if you make sure that this one is perfect, then the rest of them after that are going to be a lot easier. If this one starts out messed up, then all of them are going to be messed up after that. And you're going to have to make, by the time you get to that 12th pentagon that you're trying to glue into place, you're going to have to make a lot of adjustments. So I'm going to pause this real quick. I'm going to make sure this is glued up, and I'll let you know how long it took. All right, so it's taken me about 20 minutes to get to this point. The glue is actually still wet at this point, but it has tacked up enough to where I can handle it and I can start working on gluing the next piece in. One of the other things that I did just to give it a little strength while I'm working with it, because I know the glue is still tacky, is I took some CA glue, and on the inside joints I just went across it a little bit, across the surface on the three joints, and then I hit it with my acceleration spray. That's basically just going to act like a piece of tape on the inside here. It's not adding any structural integrity. It's not doing anything like that for the piece. It's just helping hold it together while I handle the other pieces and while I'm gluing them in. Now at this point, if you've done a really good job, at this point it's your base point. So the rest of your pieces should start to fit in real nice and easy with minimal adjustments. And like I was saying earlier, I was lucky enough on my three spears to only run into issues with one of them, and that was the third one as I was coming around to the top. You should be able to pick up any of your other pentagons, yeah, and just fit them in there. Just drop it in, see how it looks. And what you can see is I put an X here, because when I picked this piece up and I set it in without any adjustment at all, that joint is about as perfect as it's going to be. And I held it up to the light, I looked through it to make sure it was good. And the other thing that I was inspecting is the inside. You want to look at your inside seams as well. I'm kind of just holding this by hand, so I'll see if I can give you a good look at it. But you're looking at your joint in here, and you want to hold it up to light, see kind of what you got coming in there. And you also want to look at your valleys here. How well do they line up? And I don't know if you can see it in the camera, but these valleys are pretty much right on. And that's with no adjustment whatsoever. Some of them may need some adjustment, but if I check this in that one, see, I've got a really good fit. But on this joint here, I see a little tiny bit of light. Just a little bit, not much. And on this one, it's the same thing. I just got a little tiny bit of light right there. And that could be simply because I have not cleaned these corners out yet. There's a little bit of crusty glue in there. So I'm going to come in with a razor blade and make sure that those are nice and clean, because if that point's not touching in there the way that it should be, then you're going to have an issue. And just by cleaning that out, my joint is a lot tighter. There's still a little bit of light, but not too much. So I marked this one with an X because this one fits right here. I don't need to adjust it. I can just glue it in. And this is actually a pretty easy glue up. You don't need anything complicated. Again, if your joints are nice and tight, you don't even need tape. You don't need a clamp. All you want to do is put a little bit of glue on there, enough to give you some squeeze out and to make sure that you've got a good glue joint. You don't want to get crazy and just put a big glob on there. I know when you're gluing together like a cutting board or something like that, a little extra glue is never going to hurt you. But in this case, it actually will slow you down. It's not necessarily going to hurt you, but the more glue you have in there, the more these pieces are going to want to slip around. So as you can see, I've just got a nice light glaze of glue in both joints there, and I'm just using my finger. Some people have to use a brush or something like that. I don't know why, it's just wood glue. But what I'm going to do is, after I put the glue on there, I'm just doing this in real time, is I'm going to let it sit for just a second, maybe about a minute, maybe less. And the reason that I'm doing that is I want the glue to be exposed to the air for just a minute. That way it'll kind of tack up. It'll absorb into the wood just a little bit. And I think that's long enough. You can kind of look at it and tell it kind of loses its gloss just a little bit. All I'm going to do for this glue joint, I'm going to take the two pieces and I'm going to kind of rub them back and forth until it sets into place right where I want it to be. And you can see I've got squeeze out. It's just not a whole lot. It's perfect. It's just enough. And then I'm going to come in here with my finger, and on the inside I'm going to clean that glue joint out. I had a paper towel and it disappeared. Give me 1 second. Oh, there it is. It's on the floor. So I'm going to clean that glue joint out, and the only reason I'm cleaning the glue off of it is because I want to make sure that my seam is tight and that everything is lined up. I'm also going to do the same thing with the outside. I'm just going to wipe that excess glue off of there. And by hand, I'm going to push it in as hard as I can, just for a few seconds, and let loose, and you'll see you get a little extra squeeze out. That's it. At that point, it's just gonna sit like that. The one thing that I will do is I will move on to fitting the next piece. And as I'm fitting the next piece, I'm just letting that dry. But at this point, you can check it also, because these two angles here should be flat across, and hopefully you can see that in the video. But there is no daylight between those angles. I mean, it's as flat as it's ever going to be. And if it's not flat across, you don't want to take it to your sander and make it flat, because you're just going to create an even bigger issue around when you start to wrap that corner. If you've taken the time to get all your angles right ahead of time when you set that on there, I mean, there's no wobble to it at all. It is flat. And that's just another way to check and see where you're at and how your entire project's going. But while that's drying, I can take my next piece and start fitting it, and I can hold it up, and I don't know if you guys can see this, but the joints in there, there's no light coming through them. They look really good. My corners look like they line up. I'm gonna hold it up to the light real quick and see if it fits. And then we'll move on from there. So as you can see, my glue is wet on this joint. I just glued it together and just forced it in there by hand, and that's it. And I'm going to come back and look at the other joint right now. This is the one, this joint over here is the one that I just held together earlier. You can see the X's on it. And that glue is tacked up pretty well. If I give it a good squeeze, nothing happens. My joint's tight. My valleys are good, and at this point I can just continue on. I'll fit the next piece, and then after that I'll start fitting my pieces in between. And there's no great science or anything wow about it. It's just a matter of fine adjustments on your sander to get your pieces to fit in there just right. Okay, I'm back. I had to switch out the SD card in my camera. It was full, so it only took me a few seconds. If you take a look at these joints, you can see the glue is still pretty wet on it, so I was only gone for a few seconds. But as you can see, this glue up is going pretty fast, and I'm actually running out of pieces to glue. I only have two more pieces, and this one I really can't glue in here because I have veneers in between each of my joints. And what that does is you're adding a 42nd of an inch in between each one of these joints. So this octagon is actually larger than this octagon that does not have the veneer joints in there. So this piece, I would have to do a lot of fitting on it in order to make it work. So I'm just going to talk about these joints here for a second. These joints where you're just fitting in to one corner, they're actually really easy. But then you get to the point where you've got to fit these three in, and then the last three that go up in here, they're the most complicated to fit in place, but they're still really not that bad. If you're off to a good start like this one is, where all the joints are extremely tight, then by the time you get to the top, you're just going to be making very minor adjustments. When you hold that piece up in there, what I was doing is I would flip each one around until I found the absolute best fit. And in this case, that's the best fit. And I don't know if you can see, but there's a little tiny bit of a gap here. And that gap, just looking at it, is about a 32nd of an inch, maybe a little bit less. I'm tight here, but if you can see that, my edge is a little high, which means I need to shave a little off of this side. And if I do that real quick, and then slide it back in, and I barely took anything off. Now, you probably can't see it in the video, but this side has dropped just a little bit, just because I took a hair off this side. Now, because I know that this is the side that I want to adjust, that these three sides are the sides I'm fitting, I'm gonna make a mark here, and in this case, I'm just gonna do a Y. And that's just a reference point. Now, by seeing that this side up here is high and that I have a gap on this side, that basically means that if I take this side and I slide it down into place, as you can see, then this side lines up a little bit better, but there's a gap, there's still a gap there, and I can see that the bottom of my angle is touching but the top of it is not, and this angle down here is really tight. So what I might have to do is back bevel this angle just slightly, and I'm talking maybe a quarter of a degree, maybe even less. And I'm just doing that by hand. What I'm doing is I'm sliding it up on my sander, and I'm just lifting it by hand a little bit just to take that little quarter of a degree off of there. And until you get it in your hand and you start messing with it, you're really gonna have a hard time kind of understanding what I'm doing, because a lot of it is hands-on. Now, if I look at it, I have probably only taken off about a hundredth of an inch off of this side and about the same on each side, because when you're sanding these by hand, it is impossible to get them 100% accurate. So you are gonna need some fine-tune adjustment. But the key to this entire project is to take the time to make sure that your joints are right. Now, I can see that this joint here is really tight, this joint is really tight, my gap here is about half the size that it used to be, but I'm a little bit high in my corners, which tells me that I need to take a little bit more off of the back side here. Not much. Again, I'm just barely, you can hear how long it hits the sander. I'm probably shaving like a thousandth of an inch off at a time. And that is really close. That little bit has tightened. I don't know if you can see that, but it has cut this thing down. There's maybe a hundredth of an inch gap there. This is 100% tight. This is 100% tight. I'm a little bit high right there, but if I push down on it so that I'm level, then I can see that over here, my gap widens just a little bit, and that I'm touching right in this corner. So what I'm gonna do over here is I'm gonna make a little mark. And typically I wouldn't do this, I would just go ahead and adjust it, but I'm gonna take off maybe about a hundredth of an inch to zero. And what that looks like is I'm gonna touch it to the sander real gently, and then I'm just gonna, with this thumb, just give it a little bit of pressure and take a little bit off of that corner. And you can hear it touch. And typically I do this entire process with the sander running. It goes pretty quick once you get used to doing it. Okay. Now, even with me kind of talking and having a conversation and doing all of this, it still took less than 5 minutes for me to get all these angles. And it's hard to see in the camera, but my angles, if I push them together, are really tight. So really what it comes down to is just finesse and knowing how to adjust your angles and your pieces so that they all fit together properly. And again, this one, what I'm going to do is I would just put glue on the three sides, press it into place, hold it for a minute or two, and then move on to the next one and just keep going around. This was the first sphere that I glued together. There's nothing special about it. There's no veneers in between. There's no accents, nothing like that. This sphere from start to finish to glue together took me about an hour and a half. I was able to get all the spheres glued together, as you can see. And I didn't run into any major problems with the glue up process. That's because I spent a lot of time and prep work on making sure my angles were as close as possible before I started the glue up. Of course, there were some minor adjustments and things like that, but nothing overwhelming, nothing too crazy. The big issues that I had was with the video part of it. I'm really not a good videographer yet. I don't know much about it. And the further I get into the process, the more I learn about it and the better I get at it. This particular part of the video, this last section, it took me 4 days to shoot it, and I ended up having to reshoot it at least 30 times because I had issues with the camera, issues with editing, issues with lighting, issues with sound, and it all came down to how much I know about it, which is almost nothing. So I'm hoping video 4 is a little bit better, and as I go on, I hope the videos get much better. This is kind of the beginning stage. So what this is right here for me is it's a blank canvas for my next step, which is going to be in video 4. For a lot of people, this is a good stopping point. You can leave the sphere as it is with all the angles on it and just sand it down, and it actually looks pretty cool just like that. Or you can turn it into a sphere. You can do whatever you want with it at this point. For me, this is just the beginning. This is kind of like the equivalent of an artist stretching his canvas before he does the painting. Because now what I'm going to do is I'm going to add in all the pieces that are going to make this completely unique and that are going to set this apart from anything else that's out there. And we're going to start to document that in video number 4, and I'm going to take you along for that ride. What we're going to be making is one of these. Hopefully you can see that. This one, this particular piece, it has 6 of the half moons in there. And that's not what I want to do for the next one. It's going to be the same pattern, the same look, but because I'll show you this sphere a little bit better. Because this is made up of octagons, I want to have 5 of the half moons in there. I don't want to have 6. That way my half moons will line up with each point of this pentagon. And this one is actually too narrow in diameter. This one is about 1 1/8 inch, roughly. It's kind of in between 1/8 and 1/16. And the one that I want to make, I want it to take up more of this space in here. So I want it to be about 1.5 inches in diameter total. And we'll go over in video number 4 how to figure out how big around your piece is going to be when you're done and how to get it there. It's going to be a lot of work, but if you're interested in it, come back for video number 4 and you can find out how it's done. Thanks for following my videos up to this point. And I hope you've enjoyed them, and I hope they've been informative. If you want more content, you can follow me on Instagram. It's at Eli Polite. So I'll see you in about 2 weeks with video number 4.